Did he? Well, that's cool. I'll be back. What's that?
You shoot him a text to come back.
Perfect. All right. Ready, everybody? Drop your stuff. Let's come out. Damn, ready, buddy? And you mind being out here with me to help out with stuff? Okay, welcome. Welcome, welcome, welcome to the Faraday Show. Applause before I even did anything. You all are great. This is great. Thank you so much for coming to the Faraday Show. Well, we try to make science fun. Just warning everybody, as it says on the board, there will be fire, loud noises, debris. And tonight, today actually, this afternoon, you get to see one man risk his life for the sake of science. And that man is not me. That man is Professor Mark Croft. Professor Mark Croft has been making, hey, give it up. Professor Croft has been making science fun and entertaining for more years than I could even politely tell you. So take it away, Mark.
Well, first of all, what I'd really like to do is thank all of our helpers, undergraduates, and Jon Mayes, who's come in to help. These guys are a tremendous crew. I really have to thank them all from the bottom of my heart for allowing me to do something. I started off doing this for my kids, and now I do it for my grandkids, and they've helped me keep going long after I should have probably stopped. And I appreciate their efforts to allow me to do so. It's a true personal favor. In addition, then they're such professionals in addition to being enthusiastic.
Well, they're such professionals. Let's give it up one more time for the helpers. It wouldn't happen without them. Thank you. Us professionals, Mark, not so much. I don't know.
Okay, well, we do this a little bit like a physics course, and we found in physics courses they like to have a few demonstrations to illustrate the physics and to have a little fun along the way. And we found that they enjoy it best when the professor is embarrassed, a little even better if he's humiliated, and it even gets better yet if he's in danger. And the real payoff is if he gets hospitalized and class is over. We may fake about getting close to that, but I should be just fine. There'll be some things here, though, you guys shouldn't try at home.
Speaking of hospitalization, let's put a little romance in it.
Yeah.
There we go.
Lighting a candle for me already, huh?
Well, you know, I care about them, like I do.
My shoes aren't even cold. Okay. So the first thing we'll do is Newton's first law, the law of inertia. Objects at rest tend to stay at rest. And here I have a bunch of objects at rest, and hopefully they're going to stay at rest. The classic example of this is me on the couch at home, and my wife can't get me off the couch, and I'm an object at rest, and I stay at rest. These are, of course, my wife's finest china. If I pull it slow, they come with me, but if I pull it really fast, I won't have to buy a new pair of glasses or a new nose. Of course, you can go home and do this with your parents' finest china, right? No, don't try that one at home. You have to have just the right conditions to not get in trouble on that one. The second part, I can just bounce them off here. The second part of the law of inertia is that things moving at a constant speed in a straight line also keep moving at constant speed in a straight line unless they're acted upon by something outside, which we call a force. And here I'm going to shoot this over here. I'll just put on, hit. You see, it goes in a nice straight line at constant speed until it interacts with that lead brick right there. And then it sort of bounces off and comes back. If I put another fellow right here, whoops, the wrong one. Yep, put him down. Okay, I can shoot him at there and the two of them bounce off each other. This guy has inertia of motion, which is we call momentum, and he transfers his momentum to this other fellow, turn him back on. He transfers his mass times velocity to this. Oop! That guy is too much friction. He's out of.
There we go.
He's dead. Okay.
He's tired.
And so that's the law of an object staying in motion when at a constant speed unless acted upon by an outside force. Now Aristotle thought about these sort of things thousands of years ago, But poor old Aristotle didn't have hovercraft, and so he thought to keep an object moving, you had to keep pushing all the time. That's because he had to deal with friction, and that dominated his life. We'd have been a couple thousand years ahead of time if he would have had just a hovercraft. Okay. Newton's second law. Oh, dear. Well, I hope it still works. Newton's second law is that force equals mass times acceleration. And so if you take a constant force and you put that force on a very little object, they say a little kid, you push a little kid hard and he falls over and goes flying off. And then a bigger kid, you push hard, he doesn't move as fast. Maybe I shouldn't be pushing kids around.
Keep telling him, he keeps on doing
it. Here is a small mass right here, and I put a force on him, and he goes shooting off there at a high speed.
And we forgot to tell you not to sit in the front row. We apologize.
Yeah, we warned you.
We had the warnings. So
this is a piece of wood. It has more mass, and so I can give him some force acting on him, and he doesn't move nearly as far. That's good. We got you scared now. And now this is a lead brick, and he has so much mass that I can exert a great deal of force on him, and he hardly moves at all. Okay? He does not like to change his velocity from zero. I can even put my hand underneath here and beat on my hand, and it doesn't hurt a bit.
Not a bit.
Where are my magnets? They were here a second ago. Ah, yes. They would have bitten me if they were alive. I should probably do those. Another thing that Newton dealt with was his law of gravity. We won't talk much about that here, but he knew about magnets. And the really neat thing about magnets is it gave him a way of thinking. You saw those two pucks hit each other. They had to touch each other to exert a push or a pull on each other. But if you take these magnets and you send one by the other, they grab onto each other even if they're going to miss each other. Okay? That's action at a distance. That's one of the very important parts of physics also. Gravity does it, magnetism does it, and Newton got it from magnets. Now, this is just for the fun of it, and we'll see if it will work right now. They've been disarrayed a little bit. Oh, do I have my laser pointer? Oh, here's... the nice thing about physics is you can do as much mathematics as you want, and then you can stop and go off and do something else. Okay? Well, Plato, a long time ago, figured out there were only five regular solids that were convex. Tetrahedron, the cube, the octahedron, the dodecahedron, the icosahedron. Magniformer toys, you can build these things. And I have all of those shapes right over there except for the dodecahedron. And unless this has gotten moved around too much, I should be able to build quickly for you. A dodecahedron. So these magform tools blocks are very, very fun, and they allow you to get an idea of solid geometry at an age where I couldn't make a dodecahedron up until I bought these things.
Okay. So you saw Professor Croft hit a bunch of blocks with a hammer. What does a hammer exert? What does a hammer provide? A force, good. And what did that force do? It pushed it, yes? But then what was the outcome? What happened to the blocks? You shout it out. It fell, they started to move, they accelerated, there was a change in velocity. So if I exert a force on this bowling ball with a string, if the string exerts a force on the bowling ball, what will happen to the bowling ball? It'll pull up, it will accelerate. There we go. But what happens if I pull up fast? What do you think will happen if I pull up fast? If I pull up fast, the bowling ball drops. What that's called is a jerk. It's the rate at which acceleration happens, the rate at which a force is exerted. Right here, I am the jerk. You look in the physics dictionary, there's jerk, there's Jon Mayes. And no offense, but all of you are jerks. Hopefully at least once a day. Hopefully once a day you all are jerks. maybe twice, maybe a couple times if you're like me, I don't know. It's good to stay regular. So at least once a day, you're a jerk, because you pull slowly, you exert a force to accelerate the toilet paper slowly, get enough toilet paper, then what do you do? What do you do? You jerk! Boom! So you jerk at least a couple times a day. There you go.
Oh, I need a balloon. I don't have a balloon in my pocket. Anybody got a balloon?
Balloon? Anybody? Anybody got a balloon?
I often have balloons in my pocket. Balloon. But now what I want to talk about is Newton's third law.
Balloon, you push me,
I'll push you just as hard in the other direction for law. And it's the force-reaction force law. And for that, you need to be able to divide the world into two parts. One of A, which pushes on B, and B, which pushes back on A. Okay. I need that extra help to get it started. Okay, so now. They do get harder to blow up every year.
You know, they must make better balloons.
Yeah, they've been making great balloons lately. So now I have the air inside the balloon and the balloon. And if I let go of it, the balloon is going to shrink, and it's going to push the air in that direction, and it will push the balloon in the other direction, so there'll be an equal and opposite force. If you would add up the masses times the velocity of the two, the momentum of the system would stay the same. The amount, the mass times the velocity. But so let's let this guy go. Well, the students typically don't enjoy that all that much.
We like to do it a little bigger at Rutgers, so instead of the air, we have better air, compressed air. Let me pull the pin like a grenade, and instead of a balloon, we have Professor Croft.
A hot air balloon. Okay. Whoa.
That's all that holds them together.
Yes. This has high-pressure carbon dioxide. Actually, it's a liquid in there. It will turn into a gas. It's been pressurized. I hope I'm not going to lose my back brace.
And those of you in the front row, I apologize if we didn't warn you. Protect your eyes and your cameras and any delicates, yep. Your life in general.
So I'm going to hold this. I'm going to blow it in one direction, and it should blow me controllably in the other direction. Bear in mind, I am 68. I have an artificial right knee, and I need another one. Okay, here we go. I have to work up my courage.
How's it going, Mark? How's it going? I can't do the show by myself, so that's a good thing.
You're going to take your demo right now, right?
So, what was it that pushed Mark there? Air! And we take air for granted. What is air? What is air? Yes, what's made of? Where is it? Shout it out, where is it? All around us, we take it for granted. We don't even think of it as being there. But as we saw, air can exert an extremely large force. And if it exerts that force over an area, it becomes a pressure. Well, instead of using air to push things, what do we use air for if, for instance, we want to use a straw to drink soda? We use it to suck things up, to pull things. Perfect. So here I essentially have a very large straw. This very large straw is connected to a vacuum pump, which I hope still works. What we're going to do is, just like you sucking up soda out of a straw, we're going to suck all the air out of this tube. On this side of the tube, I have a ping pong ball. Tell me, can ping pong balls puncture soda cans, speaking of soda and straws? Can they? You must be the Hulk, just like hitting a ping pong ball on the table. Boom, taking out soda cans. All right, can ping pong balls really puncture soda cans? What do you think? Probably not. Thank you. So let's see if they can. Again, I am going to take all the air out, and the air slowly comes out, slowly, 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 slowly. You can feel the end. The end is starting to bend in. And then, if I give the ping pong ball somewhere to go, just like the soda in your straw goes in your mouth, that ping pong, wow! Well, it's not a ping pong ball anymore, but that ping pong ball has turned our soda cans into kebabs. One soda can, two soda cans, three soda cans, and our poor ping pong ball. Behold the awesome power of air.
Actually, that ping pong ball was traveling at 700 miles per hour when it hit those, almost the speed of a bullet. And it had a lot of energy of motion, and that energy of motion went into breaking up those cans. We'll talk about energy of motion a little bit more in a bit. Now we're going to talk about things that move in circles. And I always like something on a rope to illustrate this, because a rope can only do one thing. I can pull up towards my hand.
Can you push with a rope, Mark?
No, I can't push. I can't make it go like that, like this. I can only pull towards my hand. Now, I wiggle my hand a little bit and get some circular motion, but the basic force, if it wasn't for friction, would be pointing always just towards the center of the circle, because that's the way the taut rope points. And so objects that are in circular motion always have a center-seeking force, which is, they call the centripetal force. And so let me see if I can, haven't hit him yet, but I'm going for John. Ready?
Hey!
Here we go.
Oh! All right!
Sorry about that. That's a danger of sitting in the front row.
That's how we keep the audience involved. There you go. So I lit a candle before for some physics romance, but what would a candle-lit dinner be without some bubbly? So behold the pressure buildup, the force exerted over an area due to air again. Here we go. Boom! Hey, oh, you all right, bud?
You okay?
Dangerous being in the front row, man. I told you. I told you. All right.
You got their waivers, right?
Yeah. Oh, it's not our fault, I promise. All righty, Professor. You look like you could use a drink.
Yes.
A little more in there.
Thanks.
Hey, well, you know, it's Sunday, last day of the show. There you go. You know what? Let me put a little more in there. The people in the front row look a little dry.
I don't know if we've been able
to. Hey, you're welcome. No problem.
This looks like it's off. Off.
Yep, a little bit. Only one way to find out.
It doesn't look right.
That looks a little broken. You're right. Might as well just try it. Might as well just try
yeah,
it.
Yeah, I will try it.
Oh, that's
worse.
Broken.
That's worse. Okay. The professor always makes it worse.
No, I think that's even worse. That's okay, though.
Okay.
Everybody in the front row, you brought your change of clothes, yeah? No? Okay.
Well,
I do not suggest shielding yourself with an iPad on this one.
If I do this right, I should swing around in a circle, and I should be pulling down at the top with a hard enough pull that I overcome gravity and leave the water behind or the champagne behind. And so I hope everybody in the front row has a change of clothes.
It is off at an angle, Professor.
Yeah, I know.
Here we go. There's only one problem.
I don't know how to stop.
Just keep doing that the whole show.
The
I got the rest.
Lecture.
I got the rest. Don't worry about it. Oh, hello. All right. That's all you, Professor. You deserve it. You deserve it. So we talked about things.
I needed that. I am over 21.
Yeah. So we talked about things that move in a circle. But there's another type of movement that's very similar to moving in a circle that ice skaters do. What type of movement is that? Spins, I heard all of you say. It spins. So here I have a stool that will allow me to spin. And for the engineers and physicists and mathematicians in the crowd, I have my axes of rotation. I used to have weights, but it was too much having three dumbbells up here, so. So, If I begin to spin, I start to spin. Let me just make sure I'm not going to clock anybody or...
Everybody watch out.
I think we're good. These axes feel a little loose. I apologize ahead of time. If I begin to spin, you'll notice it's similar to the circular motion, but I'm spinning. Tell me, what do ice skaters do if they're spinning slowly like this, but they want to go faster? They put their arms in. So I would explain how that works, but I need a minute. You're about to see projectile vomiting. Professor Croft, you got this one?
That was the conservation of angular momentum. It's the mass, how far the mass is from the axis of rotation times how fast it's going in a circle that matters. Okay? And so it actually goes like the square, and so it's how far it is from the axis of rotation is really important. Of course, you know this because if you've ever walked along a narrow board, say a 2x4, and you start to fall, what do? You stick your arms out, and you slow down your rotation. You do the same thing you did there. And when the skater, of course, they go around and they go like this, but then they put their hands together and they put their hands over their head, and if you're like me, you pull in your stomach and you really speed up. And then when they want to slow down, they go. They stick every bit of mass as far from the axis of rotation as they get it, and they slow down on a dime. Okay. Okay, so that's rotation. Oh, I wanted to go back one to the slide. It's all very well and good about ice skaters, but in the universe, very often you have clouds, and gravity is making these clouds collapse. And when they do, they form stars and galaxies, depending on the size of the cloud. And it ends up collapsing into a disk because the original cloud was rotating and it had to conserve angular momentum. All the mass that comes together like this automatically conserves angular momentum, but if it moves towards the center, it has to speed up. And so clouds that are rotating that collapse to form things like our solar system. Here's our solar system. It's a pancake shape. Because it formed out of a rotating cloud with the sun being at the center when it collapsed. Here's a spiral galaxy seen top on. Here's another spiral galaxy seen from the edge. You see, it's a pancake. Pancake because of conservation of angular momentum. Astronomers use this all the time. Of course, there you've got the rings of Saturn, which also are right around the equatorial axis and are very, very, very thin. Okay, so angular momentum is important all over the universe.
So we talked about angular momentum, and when ice skaters pull their arms in, that amount of spinning mass, the spread of the mass from the center and the amount of spin has to be conserved together. But there's another quantity that's conserved, and for that I'm going to get up on... Never mind. Professor Croft is going to get up on a ladder. Going to get up on a ladder. Yes.
And now what we're going to go back and talk about energy. If I have an object... and I would throw it very gently to John, it would not have much energy of motion. On the other hand, if I was angry at John, which I never am, I could wind up and really throw it at him fast. It would have a lot of energy of motion, okay? There's a second kind of energy that one has to think about because we have gravity acting. If I drop this guy from really high up, it has a high energy, potential energy, energy of position, because if I let go of it, it can convert that energy into energy of motion when it hits the ground. And if I drop it from really low, it has very low energy of position. So things in the universe and in the world very often convert energy of motion back and forth to energy of position.
So here I'm going to exert a force over a distance. For those physicists and engineers in the crowd, I'm doing work to increase the energy of height right up to Professor Croft so he can put his money where his mouth is.
Or my mouth where, well, let's not even go there. Yeah. can you see what's in the way down there? It's a brick. Is it perpendicular? It doesn't matter.
You want me to hold it?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, hold it right in front of you. And smile. So I'm going to start this with a very high energy of position. When I let go, it will convert it in energy of motion, which ends up being energy of destruction, and here it goes. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
No problem.
Okay, fire in the hole. Okay. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to hold it up to my nose. And it's going to start at rest by my nose. And so whenever it gets back to this same height, it will convert it all to energy of motion at the bottom of the swing. But by the time it gets back here, it will be all energy of position. And I don't have to worry about taking off my glasses or consulting a cosmetic doctor redoing in my nose. I know it's not going to hit me in the nose. I just know it's not going to hit me. I know it. I know it. Okay. Sometimes.
Give it up for Professor Croft. He rests his beautiful face.
We don't let John do that trick. He has more to lose if it goes wrong.
Oh, you make me blush, you stuff. Okay, keep it coming.
Okay, where are we now?
Oscillator for energy.
Oh, yes. Well, I would also like to...
I got it, Professor.
...put in the background that, and I want the... I don't know if it will be easy. Just move it down. No.
Oh,
no.
This?
No.
Nope. Yeah.
There we go. Okay, that, of course, that when it swang back and forth was a pendulum. And here is a simulation of a pendulum. And I want you to notice that the long pendulum repeats its motion, and the short pendulum does it faster or slower? Faster. And here I have a spring. A spring can convert, it can have energy of position because you can stretch the spring. And there's energy stored in the spring, and you can get exercises and pluck your chest hairs at the same time. If I hold it like this, and I start it from rest, and then I pull it, I've put energy into the spring, energy of position, stretch spring. I let go of it, and it goes into energy of motion of the object. And the energy goes back and forth all the time, just like the pendulum. That's why you can have pendulum clocks, and you can have spring clocks, and now you can have electrical clocks. So the energy's going back and forth in both of these cases, energy of position and energy of motion, but you see the little mass and the big mass switch the energy of motion and position on different time scales. It's extremely predictable. Everything in the world can have energy of position and energy of motion and change them back and forth. And it's a property of that particular object. And so, which ones are we going to do?
So, you just saw Professor Croft put energy into just the mass on a spring. And it oscillated, it vibrated, but you could really put energy into anything. And if it has too much, it wants to get rid of it. What happens to you the day after Halloween when you have 4 pounds of chocolate and candy and sugar? What do you like the next day? Oh, bellyache, true.
Yes.
On top of that, more importantly for your parents, you're like, I want to go to the zoo. Parents, what happens if you have a big project and you have 5 cups too many of coffee that day?
I can type.
The same thing happens with objects. You put too much energy into objects, and it wants to get rid of it. For instance, here we have a wine glass. And for all the youngsters in the crowd, if you go out to a fancy restaurant with your parents, you're allowed to do this. It's physics. It's OK. So we have this wine glass. Get our finger wet. And I rub the edge of the wine glass. By rubbing it, I'm putting energy into it. And it doesn't want that energy, so it vibrates like you with too much coffee or sugar and gets rid of it. What type of energy is it getting rid of it? Into. Shout it out loud. What type of energy? Sound. Sound energy. So if you got to a nice restaurant, start doing that. Be like, no, Ma, it's physics. It's fine. You could do that with literally any shape, even a rod that you pick up from Home Depot or Lowe's.
This is just an aluminum rod. And here you have the case in which he tickled the thing, and the stretching of the glass was the potential energy. and then it would vibrate. That's the energy of motion. So the energy was going back and forth. It just so happens the time it took to go back and forth coupled into sound waves that you could hear. Okay, so it's still the energy of position, energy of motion that was being coupled there. Here I have an object that if I hold it right here, it can't vibrate, but if I tickle it with some rosin from a violin bow, I will tickle it and it will respond at a certain vibrational way. Actually, it's the top of those vibrations up there with maximums of vibration on the ends and zero at the middle. And so here I'll go and tickling it will have its own natural frequency of vibration. Okay, if I grab it at the end, I kill it because that's where it likes to vibrate. I'm holding it at the center, it can't vibrate. Now the next most complicated one, I choose so that I hold it a little further up towards the end. And this should give me a higher frequency of vibration. I'm just checking on my markers. The zero is closer to the end, and so it turns out the wavelength is shorter, and it turns out the frequency is higher. I'll show you an illustration of that with a simulation in a second. But so I tickle it up here. It's a higher tone. Okay. I tickled it, holding it here, and it set up this vibrational pattern. I then transferred my fingers over here, and it didn't stop because that was a zero of vibration. And then I grabbed it at the center to prove that it had a maximum of vibration at the center. So these are very, very, very specific things. It's the sense, it's the principle of all musical instruments have this sort of thing going on in them.
You want to excite the rod a little higher, Mark? There's not enough unhappy dogs in the neighborhood.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
See, when I was younger, I always wanted violin lessons, but we didn't have a lot of money, so instead I got rod lessons. It wasn't very fun, but it was cheap. So.
All right, we'll go to the highest frequency.
Oh, so soothing. That's nice. Oh. That's nice. I can take a nap. That's good. All right. You want to go even higher?
Yeah. You want to do the highest one?
Man, you're sick.
Okay. I can't do that one.
Ah, okay.
You can do it.
It's for the benefit of everybody else. All right. Give it up for Mark. Okay, so let's see exactly what was going on in the rod. Sound wave is a pressure wave, meaning it goes in and out like this. And that's what the wave inside of the rod looked like. The waves that you see most commonly look like what? Make the shape with your arm. What do they look like? Yes, good. They look like this, they look like that. So let's make an example of what that shape looks like. This rope is just like that rod. If I start to put energy into it, you'll notice it vibrates very easily at first. What type of a wave is this that you see on the playground? Jump rope, I heard somebody say. Very good, the first one. I put a little more energy in. Oh, too much.
Down in frequency.
Yeah, that one's tricky. If I put more energy in, you'll notice we have 0 points at certain parts of the wave. Those were the parts that he was holding on the rod. Tell me, when I put more energy in, did that wave get smaller or bigger? Smaller or bigger? Smaller! Professor, if you hold that, I'm going to try to go even bigger. You want to go even bigger?
Okay,
you want to put even more energy in? Ready? All right, and here you'll see the score. I think that's it. I think we're done.
I think we better stop there.
All right.
Let's clear that away. Now, in general,
take it all in.
Let me see if I can get the two up here. There we go. We've been talking about things that vibrate back and forth. And so I should show you a picture. Whoa, not a new tab. I should show you a picture of things that are vibrating. You've seen waves in the ocean, right? They have maximums and minimums, and they go moving along. And so here are two traveling waves on a string or in anything else. And you notice this one right here is vibrating very slowly. If it was a sound wave, it would be down here like this. This one, and you can see the distance in space between one maximum and the next maximum is very big. We call that the wavelength. How big the vibration is as it moves along. This one right here is going up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, and that's a very high frequency. And so this one has a very short wavelength. The distance between the peaks are little compared to this. But the speed of both of these waves is the same. It only depends on the rope or the air that it's traveling through, okay? So those are two types of waves. And you're going to do this one now?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So we saw kind of what the wave inside of that rod looked like. We kind of saw an approximation for what sound looked like. But physicists need evidence that's as close as possible to what's actually happening in reality. So we use special tools. You'll notice that this special tool looks just like a big metal cylinder, a big metal tube. And I am filling this tube with propane. Let's fill it up. There we go. I fill this tube with propane. Now this propane tube is exactly like a propane tube that you have on your gas grill at home. The only thing that we as physicists add to it on top of propane is sound. Raise your hand if you've ever seen sound. Who's seen sound here? Raise your hand if you've seen sound. Some of you have already been here. You only see sound if you have superhero eyes. Raise your hand if you have superhero eyes. All right, I always see hands on that one. Always see hands on that one. So the only thing that as a physicist we're going to add is a tone, is a sound. If I adjust that sound, sounds like a spaceship. There we go, it's starting.
Well, there you can see the maximums and the zeros.
Oh, I can get it better.
We have the technology. Nice.
So now you can go home and say you have, in fact, seen sound. You tell your friends at school, hey, I've seen sound. They say, nah, you just bring it up online. See, I saw sound, I told you. Now.
This one?
We can do that one. There's one thing I wanted to mention that I neglected to mention earlier. As you're setting this up, you can start setting this up.
Sure.
When I did the fire extinguisher demonstration, there is a little bit of a story that goes with that. When I first tried that demonstration, when I was young and foolish, I had a little teeny fire extinguisher, and I was on a rugged floor, and I had an old pair of skates, and nothing happened. And I got so angry, I came back the next lecture with a 50-pound fire extinguisher, a new pair of racing skates, which are now 35 years old, and if you plot on the vertical scale common sense and time on this scale, you know, things go along pretty well. Sometimes they come down a little bit, but I went to zero because I got up on a table about that big to get off the rug. And then I discovered that if I don't shoot it between my legs so it pushes on my center of mass, but if I hold it like this, it sends me into rotation. And so I blew myself translating and rotating off the table when I first did that demo. I learned a lot in that first tenth of a second as I left the table.
Okay, so we just saw sound basically by using a grill. But we can't have that in every single physics lab because, let's face it, physicists don't taste good crispy. So instead, physicists use special tools. Electronic tools, in this case, something we call an oscilloscope.
Oh,
so you can see the
dark
sound. Right. It's just like a TV, but it helps you see sound. This is very similar to the wine glass that we had before. Not quite yet on the lights. Not quite yet on the lights, whoever that was. Thank you. It's very similar to the wine glass we had before, but in reverse. in the wine glass, I rubbed it to put energy in. What did that energy come out as? Sound. And I rubbed it to do that. Here, I'm putting the energy in as sound. I'm introducing energy into the system of the beaker to add energy into it. So what is that beaker going to do, do you think? Vibrate, right? If I vibrated the beaker to make it make sound, then I do the reverse. It makes sense that if I put sound in, the beaker will vibrate in return. You can see that on the oscilloscope here. As Professor Croft said, there's only certain frequencies that everything likes to vibrate at. You put energy in, it has a frequency it vibrates at to get rid of it. This, which is 690 hertz, is the resonance frequency of this beaker. If I change it, you'll notice the amplitude of that wave, you can turn the lights off now, thank you, Mahir, goes down. The amount of that wave, the amplitude goes down. If I go just off of that frequency, and when I go back, you can see it increases quite a bit. That's because I'm putting energy in and it's making the glass vibrate. So it itself is also producing sound. Now, let's see if I go back. There we go. There we go. Again, as physicists, we want to see it in real life. Do you want to see the beaker vibrate?
Yes.
Yes, okay, all right. So here we have a strobe light. I apologize, it's going to be a little bit flashy. Here we have a strobe light on our beaker. And if I increase the amount of sound energy a little bit, you begin to see and hear it vibrate on the edges. There you go, you can see it vibrating right on the edge. And if I increase that, the amount a lot, if I increase the amplitude or loudness a lot, that beaker shatters. Thank you. All right, take it away.
You gonna do the fog now?
I'll do the fog now if you'd like. You want me to?
Let's
do fog after Bernoulli.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, now we're going to do. I need to put on the screen the Bernoulli effect.
So we talked about sound and how sound moves through air. Well, what happens if the air itself moves? We looked at the force that could be exerted by air, the pressure that could be exerted by air. But what about the moving air itself, Professor?
Oh, now, let's switch it over to
Computer.
It turns out that if you have fast moving air, the pressure or push is low. And so if you're over here on this side, if you put a balloon on top of a stream of air, it's not surprising it gets blown up. But when it tries to fall off the stream of air, the air goes by fast on this side, it goes by slow on this side, so there's little push on this side and a big push on this side, and it gets always pushed back on. So when we put it on here, it will stay.
Go. But that's not all we could do with it. Ready, sir? You wanna man the cannon here? That's not all we could do with it. It could also stabilize. Go ahead. All the way up. Toilet paper! Into the crowd. All right.
Thank you.
Take it in. We're done. Here you go.
We
just recently got a memo asking why we use so much toilet paper.
But now you
Here
know.
Here you go, just for you. There you go.
It's fogger? Okay. Oh, by the way, this is the same effect that makes airplanes fly. The airplane wing is shaped so that the air goes flying over the top of the wing with a different velocity. It's faster on the top of the wing than on the bottom of the wing, so that the airplane wing gets lift as it goes flying through the air. So the Bernoulli effect, it works there. Okay, go ahead.
So, we just said that moving air has low pressure, and it's the high pressure, slow air on the outside that keeps that stable shape, the stable spot in the middle. Here's another example. It's the most expensive piece of equipment we have at Rutgers. We had to file a grant to get this. And it is a propagating disturbance, a moving air machine. If you look at the audience members that I'm trying to hit, you'll notice that their hair is moving. Is that enough evidence for us?
No.
No, we're physicists. We want more. So we use special tools. In this case, let's bring the romance back. We have this special tool. Actually, you might have figured Jess. Her hair would be perfect. We have this special tool of a candle. And Jess's hair. Ah, I thought we were decorating the place. Special tool of a candle and Jess's hair. And when I use my air propagating device, we see it puts out the candle and pushes her hair. Is that enough evidence to go on?
No,
as physicists, we want data that is as true to life as possible, as true to what's actually going on as possible. So we have a very delicate piece of equipment here called theatrical fog, which will help us see the air so that we can see exactly what's going on in our air propagating device. All right. So you can see that the air is actually spiraling in on itself, and the act of moving keeps it stable because all of the air on the outside, the higher pressure air, is pushing it in. You want me to do it again?
Yeah.
What? I couldn't hear you.
Yeah.
Excuse me?
Yeah.
Okay, all right, okay. All right, all right, all right. Let's get the people in the back. If you got cheap seats, I have not forgotten about you. All right, there we go. There we go, that's it for now. Thank you, thank you.
Jon, why don't you start this off, then I'll do the next one, then I'll do these guys.
Perfect, sounds good. Air is made of a bunch of molecules, and those molecules move. What else is made of moving molecules? Anybody? What else is made of moving molecules? Water. Raise your hand if you like to swim. Where's it easier to float? In the ocean or in a pool? In the ocean. Why is it easier to float in the ocean? Salt, waste, garbage, oil, all those things that are in the ocean. But in all seriousness, you could do your part and prevent that from happening. Anyway, all those things that are in the ocean. Here, this is like pool water. There's some fluoride from the tap, maybe a little chlorine from treatment, but otherwise it's just tap water. And here, I have Pepsi and Diet Pepsi. The cans are identical in volume. Will the Pepsi can float? Will it float? I heard no, I heard yes. This is yes, this is no, this is I'm having a fit. Who knows? Who knows? We don't know. We're scientists. We want to try it. So we try it, and it sinks. Wah, wah, wah. Here I have a Diet Pepsi can. Will that float or will that sink? Why? Because it's diet. It has to float. It's diet. Come on. So I'll let you do that at home. We won't do that here. Is that okay with you?
No.
Oh, okay. All right. All right. We'll do it here. I put the Diet Pepsi in, and it floats. But somebody tell me, what was it that made it so much easier? Oh, whoa, wow, that was loud, I'm sorry. What was it that made it so much easier for you to float in the ocean?
Salt.
Salt. So in this same volume, the same size, the same space, we're gonna add more stuff. We're gonna put more stuff in that space, a lot more stuff. We're gonna put so much more stuff. I see we got a conservationist in the crowd. I like that. We put so much salt in that the Pepsi begins to float. There's so much stuff in this same space that it exerts more force over area, it exerts more pressure underneath to hold up the Pepsi can. And you'll notice the Diet Pepsi's floating greater too. Thank you very much.
Thanks, John. Okay. You know when I come back on that I'm doing an experiment where the experimenter has to be expendable.
As soon as I found out that I wasn't doing it, I made sure that there were three of those.
Yes. Why don't you hold those guys over there for a second? Okay. This starts off as a buoyancy experiment. That is, an object that's less dense than the medium it's in floats. And so this is a balloon, and it floats. And why does it float? Not air, helium. Helium, it has to have something less dense than air, and that is helium, the second element of the periodic table. First element. No, for a second. It just pops. Now, this is the first element of the periodic table, and it's even lighter.
This one's even lighter and more buoyant. All the chemists in the crowd, what is that?
Hydrogen.
Yes.
Which is why I gave him three balloons, and I'm going to walk over here.
Okay, why don't we get the lights down.
I'll light that up for you. There's one on the other side.
This one should do chemistry. It will burn into water and release a lot of energy rapidly and essentially blow up. And we have the center one off, too. Oh, it doesn't matter. This will be bright enough.
Yeah.
Okay, here we go.
Oh! All right. Physics, because who needs eyebrows?
Okay.
Whoa. All right.
Okay.
I smell hair. Is everybody okay? Everybody's okay? All right. Yeah.
Okay.
Oh my goodness.
Oh, he came in with a full head of hair. Oh no, God.
Oh my goodness gracious.
Okay.
So.
Now we're going to move on. In 1 second, we're going to move on to.
I'm doing this right now.
Temperature. Oh, you're going to start that one? You can start that one right now.
Yep.
So. We looked at the pressure, which is a force over an area that supports Pepsi and Diet Pepsi. We looked at the pressure that exerts a force on hydrogen and helium. We saw the awesome force. The awesome power of propelled air in both the air cannon, the propagating disturbance tool that we used, Professor Croft's fire extinguisher, and in the ping pong cannon. Here, I have a drum. This drum is full of nothing, and by nothing, what do I really mean? Air, it's full of air. So you have air inside pushing out, having a pressure inside out, keeping it in its shape. But what is the air all around us doing? It has a pressure in. It is exerting a pressure in. If I take the air out of this drum, which is very similar to me, it's full of hot air.
Now.
As physicists, let's just see what happens. We don't know what happens. Put it out of your mind. Pretend it's not even there. No sweat. I'm sorry. I apologize ahead of time. No sweat. Just pretend it's not even there. Professor?
Let me just give you a head up. It's going to go boom. Okay. An implode. If you go down to the canal and you notice that you have some regular ducks in the canal, a mallard duck or a canvasback duck, they float very high in the water. That's because they're very light. They have low mass. That's because they spread the oil from a gland underneath their neck with their bills all over their wings. They exclude the water and they float very nicely. If you go down to the Raritan River, you can often see hanging around together cormorants. They float very low in the water because they have very high density. They don't have these oil glands, and they like to dive. You've forgotten all about that, right? They like to dive down to the bottom to eat the fish on the bottom of the river. And so they like to have a high density and low buoyancy, but when they come back up, they have to hang around with their wings out to dry off. So keep an eye out for cormorants. You can also see this wicked hook on the front of their beak that gives you a tip off that they like to eat fish. Still going? Okay.
That makes me nervous, sir. I don't know.
Now.
Oh, my goodness. Everybody duck. Oh, who brought my extra pair of pants? Oh, my goodness.
You just have to be patient.
The best part of that demo is I don't have to act at all. There's no acting. So, I asked you before to witness the awesome power of air in the ping pong cannon and in the fire extinguisher. Here we see how much pressure that air inside actually exerts to help give this drum its structure. And to show you exactly how much air that is, before we saw sound here, we're going to hear the air. I take off this little fastener. There we go.
He's going to get sucked into the can, right?
Oh, hello.
And you can hear how much air was actually taken out of this can. None of us could have destroyed this can ourselves, but air did it. Thank you. Oh.
Now I want to tell you something. I'm going to do some demonstrations on temperature.
Awesome.
But I want to make sure that you understand just how a physicist thinks about temperature, and this is the way I want you to think about it the rest of your life. If you go outside and it feels cold, let me see. This is a simulation. People in front row, I guess I can see through. This is a simulation of the gas molecules moving in two gases. What's the difference between this one and this one? Faster and slower. The molecules are moving slow in the low temperature gas. That means they have low energy of motion. They are moving really fast in the high temperature gas. That means they have high energy of motion. That's all temperature is. Temperature is just a measure for a gas of the energy of motion, the average energy of motion of the molecules. It's not some fancy thing. You just look at all the energy of motion and you get the temperature. Okay, so think about that. It's a physical way to think about temperature. Also, you notice one of these balls hits the wall hard and bounces off hard. So it pushes hard on the wall. These guys sort of come in and they bounce off very gently. They push on the wall very little. So the push here, or the pressure, is very big. You can see it's 2.3, 2.4 atmospheres. And over here, it's 0.01 atmospheres. So you can also think of the pressure on the wall as the impact of the molecules. That's, of course, why the drum blew up, because the molecules on the outside were hitting it very fast, and there were not enough molecules on the inside hitting it. Okay, now I want to show you an illustration of this. This is one of my favorites. By the way, I've been a low-temperature physicist since 1966. That's a long time. No, that's okay. I've gotten used to working with these things. One should be very careful with liquid nitrogen. It can burn you very badly. I'll show you a number of things you can do, but I'll be very careful. Now, here I have a balloon. It's a helium balloon. If I let it go, it would float up to the ceiling. That's because it's less dense than the air. But I can start putting it in liquid nitrogen slowly, and I will make the molecules, just do it. The molecules are slowing down, mostly nitrogen molecules. Oh no, it's helium, the helium molecules. And so they're hitting the walls less hard. Pressure's dropping, the average energy of motion is dropping, pressure's dropping, they don't expand the balloon as much. The balloon, you can see, is shrinking very nicely. This total mass of the balloon stays exactly the same, but the volume it has decreases, and so the density is going up. And eventually I get to the point where it doesn't float anymore.
Thank you.
Watch
for
it now. Now it warms up. They start moving faster.
Now. Everybody waves.
And it floats again. Sorry about that. Didn't mean to shock you.
Gotta keep you entertained somehow.
We warned you about those front row seats.
Professor, ready?
Are you okay? No, okay.
Want to do this?
Okay. If we take some liquid nitrogen.
I have it right here.
Okay. Or I'll take a cup in my hand. If we take some liquid nitrogen and we put it in a confined space, it likes to change its volume by 200 times when it turns from the liquid gas to the gas state. Liquid state to gas state.
And this so if is the reverse of the drum. Instead of taking air out, we're putting gas in.
Yes.
Watch what happens instead.
And so we end up with a liquid nitrogen cannon.
All the way in the back.
Let's go across the room.
All right.
Oh, almost, okay, almost. One more. Put a little more in.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Now, who hasn't gotten one yet? Well, I don't know. Maybe I'll... Let's see if we can get the camera. Whoa! Oh! I got me.
I got another one. Hey!
I had you worried about the camera, didn't
I?
Now, the stuff we're using so freely up here, liquid nitrogen, I always get asked the question, hey, John, is it really dangerous? It looks just like a fluffy gas. This is just like me. This is just like me, a soft, sweaty hot dog. Now, if I was to take a hot dog and dip it in liquid nitrogen, this is what happens to the hot dog. If I was to put my hands in liquid nitrogen, I could only do it twice. So liquid nitrogen does very, very funny things.
Oh, no. Yeah, I'll do it.
Oh, you got it?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Liquid nitrogen does very, very funny things to objects when you put it inside. Go ahead, Professor Croft.
Okay, what's this? What's that? A banana split. And here I have some grapes. Oh, this, you know what this is? Broccoli.
Eat that, broccoli.
And some grapes. Okay, so liquid nitrogen can freeze things hard as a rock. Mostly it freezes the water that's in there. Everything gets a little harder as it gets colder. Now here I have some very nice flowers, and they're of course very delicate and malleable, but if you put them in liquid nitrogen, they get so cold that they turn brittle as glass. We have to let them cook for a little while first. And they're all, while they're cooking, let me tell you that, I'll do this first. They should be ready now, and they should be brittle as glass. Whoops! Yeah, poor flowers. By the way, this liquid nitrogen cannon always reminds me of my father because he used to work with explosives all his life, either for the Navy Department or other people. And he had his first job, one of his first jobs was here in New Jersey working at a nitroglycerin factory. And they brought him into his lab, he was a chemist, and they gave him this nice lab and he looked around and he saw three very strong cement walls. And then he saw this one very weak wooden wall. And he says, what's that? And he says, well, that's a blowout wall. That's why if you make a mistake, the explosion blows up. And they sweep up all the glass, they build a new wall, and they hire a new guy. And they just keep on going. Well, in point of fact, if you're ever going to work with explosives, either make sure you're working with explosives out in the free air so the explosion isn't confined with you, or you've got a blowout wall to keep you safe. Actually, there was another example here in New Jersey I heard where they would have a pit in the middle of the room. And if you were pouring things together and you suddenly realized you made a mistake and said, oh, beep, you would then throw it down the hole and you dive for the window, which were on cantilevers, and they'd swing out and the explosion would roar out over your head, if you were lucky. We're up to these guys now?
Yep.
Okay. Okay, now we're going to move over to light. Yes. Okay. Here is a picture of part of the sky. And I need a laser. I had a laser here a minute ago. There it is, hiding. Okay. If you look out in the night sky about there sometime after sunset tonight, you'll see three bright stars in a row. And those are the belt stars of Orion the Hunter. And Orion the Hunter has over his head, his hands are over his head, and in one of them it's a red star. And that star is Betelgeuse. These stars are hot white stars, and this is Rigel down on the corner. This has 11,000 degrees Kelvin. This guy has 3,000 degrees Kelvin. If you follow these three stars down to the horizon, you'll see the brightest star in the sky, Sirius, and it's also a very hot white star. So the temperature of the star corresponds to its temperature. And you have these diffraction gratings in your hand?
Go, everybody, gadget, magic glasses.
Does anybody
glasses?
Not have a diffraction grating? One of the glasses? If not, we'll have somebody bring them up to you. You can tell the temperature of an object simply by looking at it, its spectrum through diffraction grating glasses. And where is mine? Okay, doesn't matter. If you look at Betelgeuse, here it is, it's more red. And if you look at these guys, they're hot blue stars. The thing I want you to notice is that there's one region here in the Sword of Orion that actually, when you look at it, doesn't look like a rainbow. It looks like a line spectrum of just very special lines. That's because it's a glowing cloud of hydrogen. And do we have a diffraction grating here for me?
We do, Professor.
Thank you. I wouldn't know what to say without it. Okay, so now we're going to show all this to you. You can actually do the spectroscopy. And we want to hit the overhead or...
Turn that off?
This first one I want to show you right here, turn it up a little bit. Okay, turn way up. So there, you see this one? You look at it, can you see the rainbow? Yeah. Now, if we start cooling it off, making it be a lower temperature, it starts to change the rainbow. Are you turning it down?
Yes, I am.
And it's disappearing from the blue. Now it's almost gone. We need a little more than that. There we go. See that? Stop right there. You see it's now red and green mostly? That's a lower temperature. So the temperature of a hot object, like a star, we can tell with the diffraction grating. It separates the colors into different angles of coming into your eye. And so we can tell the temperature. Now this next one right here, this is very special. This is the most famous spectrum in the entire universe. Can you see that red line? Can everybody see it? That is the red Balmer line of hydrogen. That's the same as was in the Orion Nebula. The Orion Nebula has new hot young stars being born, and they're heating up the hydrogen, and they give off these series of colors. Now the next one right here, this one I want you to remember. It's much simpler looking. And do you see that wonderful, what's the brightest line? Yellow. The owl is that orange yellow. That is helium. I want you to remember that spectrum, okay? Every element of the periodic table has its own unique spectrum. It's like a fingerprint in light that it emits when you tickle it when it's in a gas form. This guy is mercury. So you wouldn't want to break this bulb. And here's another mercury-coated bulb. You see the compact fluorescence on the top here? You see a same set of colors, plus a few extra, but basically the same set of colors in the helium ball, in the helium gas, as you see it coated on the inside of the compact fluorescence bulb. That's why you have to be careful when you clean up a broken compact fluorescent.
Just remember, broken compact fluorescent equals mercury. Be very careful.
And now this is neon, the kind that they use in neon signs. And it has lots of different colors. Okay, now you guys can keep these spectrometers that I've given you, these light diffraction gratings. Yeah, we can turn up the lights. And you can do your own spectroscopy. The one thing you never look at is the sun. You never look at the sun or you end up like Galileo. Blind. Now,
you want to do your thing about
yeah, I wanted to, just in case anybody's watching at home, I want to make sure the people at home can see that the compact fluorescent showed multiple bulbs when we looked at it through through the diffraction gratings. Now, here is something that's different. Remember, here is a picture that was similar to the one taken in 1850 at a solar eclipse. And it blocked out the light from the sun, and all you saw was the atmosphere around the sun. It was glowing. And you see what you see when you put a diffraction grating? You see this yellow line here? That's the helium line. Helium is the only element of the periodic table that was not discovered on Earth. It was discovered in 1850 before they even knew what it was in the atmosphere of the sun. And they named it helium for helos, Greek for the sun. Okay? And there's the helium spectra we saw with our goggles, just in case for the people at home who weren't able to see it. And there's a series of spectra. Yes. Yes, we need lights out for
light,
one
please.
More thing. Yes.
You want this
Where's
part?
The violet
right
one?
Here.
Okay. Now, remember, blue meant higher temperature and red meant lower temperature, right? So it's the same way with light. There's more energy in violet light than there is in green light. So if I have an object like this that fluoresces and I shine a green light on it, well, it just bounces off and you can see it. But if I shine a violet light on it,
write me a message, Mark. Oh, so nice. always so cheeky.
Where is, oh yes.
Right there.
There's also another nice application for this.
What's the use of having this if you don't apply it to something useful?
Yes, here's another nice fluorescent material that I can write on with a violet.
Because let's face it, in the middle of the night, nature doesn't call, it screams.
It's a glow-in-the-dark toilet seat, which you guys will appreciate someday. I hope not, but...
All right, some fun with lights and stuff. Give it up for Professor Croft. Show him some love. All the things we were playing with before, all the things that produce light, are called what? The things that produce light that were plugged into a socket, what are they called? Light bulbs. They're light bulbs. And who invented the light bulb? Thomas Edison, or at the very least, he took credit for it. Here in the Rutgers Physics Department, it wasn't enough to use the light bulb of another. We had to invent our own. So we got creative. We were hungry one day. We're all students. All we have is the meal plan. So we made our very own pick a light. Satisfying our need to study and our need to eat, illuminating our hunger. So, if I connect this pick a light to what powers light bulbs, and what powers it? You said it, my man.
Electric.
Yes, electricity. We'll still call it electricity. Or electric voltage, for those physicists among us. Between these two electrical leads, I put the pick a in. Lights, please. I come into the office. I'm feeling a little hungry. I'm stressed because I have an exam the next day. So what do? I turn on my pick a light and nothing happens. I'm kidding. I turn it on, and then we wait a minute while it's starting. Oh, there we go. Va-boom! Our pick a light lights up. Everybody take out your handy dandy physics fun glasses of awesome and take a look at that pick a light. What spectral lines does that look like? The spectral lines of which element? Anybody? It's in the sun? Helium, but it's not
no.
really helium. Not at all. You'll see it's orange and a little yellow. What makes pickles pickles?
Sodium, vinegar, salt.
They're tasty as opposed to cucumbers, which are not. I'm kidding. It's sodium. You put sodium in a pickle, you brine a pickle with sodium, and it turns a cucumber into a pickle. And it's that sodium, which is an ion, that moves, creates a current, and lights up our handy dandy pickle light bulb. Now, you just witnessed something, and I need to tell you this in all seriousness. I'm like full of jokes. I'm super corny. I'm like just a really dorky version of Bill Nye the Science Guy, but I got to get serious with you. Ready? I just played with a live lead. I had two nails, and I had a voltage, or you could call it electricity, between those two nails. You should never, ever, ever, ever do that at home. Let me give you an example. Ready? So when I was young, I was always curious. And when I first saw TV, this little tiny moving people in the TV, that's awesome. What do you want to do? You want to go in there. I heard you. You want to go in there. You want to open up the TV, explore, go in there, and figure out what's going on. So I'm a little kid, and there's a TV. So I crack it open. I unscrew everything. I open it up. There's some stuff inside. It hasn't been watched in a while. It should be fine. You know what? As an afterthought, let me be safe. So I'll unplug it and turn it off, and now I should be good. So as I play and I play and I play, eventually at one point,
this is going to make a noise and it'll flash.
I put my hand on one part of the TV, and then I put it again on the other, and it even welded on. It welded on. It would weld my hand onto the remainder of the TV. That's because television sets and almost every single electronic device you use every day has something that stores energy, which we had discussed, electrical energy, and they are called capacitors. These two cylinders store electrical energy. So the moral of that story is, if you take something apart, even if it hasn't been used in years, it still has electrical energy inside, and you should be very, very safe. Moving on to electricity.
Okay. So now we talk about generation of electricity. Now,
I think we gotta do that first, right?
Yes, we can do that. Yes, yes. This would be better to do first, but I don't see the oscilloscope on.
Oh.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Can everybody see that green dot? Okay. That is a dot from an oscilloscope. And inside of the oscilloscope is an electron gun that shoots electrons at the front. So there's moving charged particles. And if I have a magnetic field from a magnet, the charged particles come right down the center line if I move this guy in the front, so they'll go right along the magnetic field lines. And when I do that, the spot stays right at the same spot with slight deviation. So if you shoot charged particles straight down magnetic field lines, nothing happens. No force. But the neat thing is, if you try to shoot a charged particle across magnetic field lines, it feels a force to the side. And if it shoots through the other direction, it feels a force in the other direction. And I can do that because the electron gun runs from here to here. And by the way, this is an oscilloscope and has capacitors like we've just seen over there in it. And so you wouldn't want to fool with it. They're safely covered by the glass here. But I bring this guy in here and watch when he gets close. The magnetic field pushes the spot off to one side. Okay, so when you shoot electrons across a magnetic field, they feel a force and they get deviated to one side or the other. Okay, a very unusual force. It's not like most of the forces you're used to that act along a straight line. It's a force that curves things.
And the gentleman whose namesake was taken for this lecture, Michael Faraday, he witnessed this and he said, all right, there has to be a relationship between electric charges, between electricity and magnets or magnetic fields. So what he would do is he set up a very careful apparatus.
You got to keep it on screen.
There we go. Very careful apparatus, which involved this, which is a galvanometer. It basically measures current, and a coil of copper. And what he would do is he would remove the connections to the coil, go into another room, carefully place the magnet there, then reconnect his equipment so as not to affect anything, and observe what happened. Nada, zilcho, goose egg, nothing, nada. Nothing happened. Fortunately for us, he was persistent, and he did it over and 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 over, and he got the same thing. Einstein said the repetition of the same thing and expecting a different result is the definition of insanity. Fortunately for us, he did it. Until one day, he disconnected, went in, put his magnet in place, reconnected, but he must have been exasperated because he didn't do it well and the magnet fell. What did you see? It moved. So by accident, he discovered that it's not just a magnetic field or magnets that interact with electric fields or electric charges. A moving magnetic field interacts with an electric field. It creates an electric field. And a moving electric field interacts with or creates a magnetic field, and so on and so on and so on. A good example of this, which Professor Croft is going to explain.
Actually, why don't we get switch this over? I'll do this one first.
Perfect. I like that better.
Okay. Now what I'm going to do is keep the magnetic field in place, and I'm going to roll something that is a metal down an inclined plane. And when the metal hits here, it will see a changing magnetic field. When it sees a changing magnetic field, electricity starts to flow in a circle. And so when it hits the magnetic field, it's like it's hitting butter. The energy of motion of the aluminum gets converted into electrical energy of electrons moving around inside of the aluminum. Now, if you take another version of this, on the bottom, of course, it's all cut up on the inside, but it still has a contiguous path for electricity to flow around the outside rim. And I send him through, and he sees the same effect.
A couple uninflated balloons, too. Don't inflate them out.
This guy, on the other hand, is cut up from one side, the other side, this side, that side, so no electricity can flow in a circle. So he goes through as if the magnetic field isn't even there. Okay, you've stopped the electricity flowing in a circle. We now have this guy on. This is a copper wire. This heavy piece of copper here is a piece of copper wire. An old friend of mine gave this to us. And it used to be a copper wire at Fermi Lab, the particle physics lab out in the Midwest. And it's hollow in the center because they used to have to send water through the center because they sent so much electricity through the copper that it would melt if you weren't cooling it from the inside. Cooling from the outside wouldn't work. But if I drop a really powerful neodymium iron boron
and
magnet...
Tell me beforehand, I'm sorry, Professor, tell me beforehand, is copper magnetic? No, not at all. You try to pick up pennies with a magnet, it's not going to work. Actually, pennies aren't made of copper anymore.
And so I drop this guy down here, and as he falls, the various parts of the copper see changing magnetic field, and the electricity flows in a circle, and the thing falls.
And I can take my sweet time going to pick it up.
I can't bend over that far.
I wish I could say I planned that.
It's a floating magnet in there. By the way, these neodymium iron boron magnets are things one should not have around the house if you have any young children around. They can be they're so powerful, they're extremely dangerous. Now, oh yes.
Your favorite.
Yeah, this is one of my favorites. Yes, and we're ready. This has electricity flowing in a circle. That creates a magnetic field. But it's alternating current, so the electricity flows one way and creates a magnetic field up. And then it flows the other way and creates electricity down, a magnetic field down. And so you have a constantly changing magnetic field on the top of here. And so if I put a ring on here, it will see a constantly changing magnetic field. Thank you. Constantly changing magnetic field, currents will start flowing in a circle. That will make this an electromagnet also. And two magnets either attract or repel, and I wouldn't be wasting all this time if they attracted. It's called a ring flinger. Of course, in former years, I used to invite a child to come up, and I'd say, could you put this on here for me like this? And then I would turn it on, and the poor child would come up and go like this.
Marcus has been told he's not allowed to do that anymore.
And then I'd turn it off and say, no, you put it on like this. I've decided not to do that. They would learn that this would get hot, though, because of the electricity flowing through it. Now, by the way, here is one that's had a cut in it, so no electricity can flow in a circle. So when I turn it on, it doesn't jump. Of course, the children don't trust me at all by now. And I have to show that I'm really turning it on so that the one that is solid jumps and the one with a cut in it doesn't jump. then I have to prove it's really electricity that's flowing, that's doing this. And of course, the best way to prove that is to take an object like this and put a light bulb across that gap and light a light bulb with the electricity. But it's easier to do it with many, many windings instead of one and make a transformer. And I can light a light bulb with no physical contact except the changing magnetic field between the two. Okay, we'll stop that there. Okay?
All right, I think we're good. Give it up for Mark real fast. He needs some love. Come on.
Oh, wait.
I mean, Professor Croft.
Wait.
All right, we'll let you go.
I forgot one last one. If you make the conductivity or the resistance to the flow of electrical current less by cooling off the thing, it's like a ring flinger on steroids. It jumps much higher. Okay, why don't we stop? Now you can proceed.
All right. Well, Professor Croft, I don't know about you, but I'm just really tired. Are you tired?
Sure, I'm tired.
It's been a long show. I mean,
I'm dead on my feet.
You know, don't say that. Not yet, anyway. What do you say we give Professor Croft something to make him a little more awake? What do you do if you're really tired? What do you take? You take a nap. Professor, I got a special bed for you to take a nap on right over here.
Oh, you're so thoughtful.
You know, it's really just because I care. Here you'll see I have a bed of very real and very sharp nails. Professor, there's your pillow. A nap wouldn't be a nap without a pillow, right? There you go. Take your time getting down. It's all about you taking a rest. All about you taking a rest. You took your microphone off. Very good. Okay, we don't want to hurt that. No, it's fine, you're fine, you're fine. Okay, there we go. Okay, all right. Now, I have a question. When you take a nap, do you just want to lay down on a bed or a couch? What do you need to help you take a nap? Blankets. You need blankets to help you take a nap. So, Professor, just for you, I took the time to make a blanket. No. Do you want your nap or not? Come on. Your blanket, very gently, there you go. Now, when you take a nap and it's the dead of winter, do you want a little tiny skimpy sheet to take a nap on with? No, what do you want? You want a big down comforter, a big fluffy down comforter. Who wants to help me make this a big down comforter for Professor Croft? Come on up, come on up. Professor, how's it going? You comfy yet? It's going great. You comfy? Hey, what's going on, bud? What's your name? Nicholas? High five, Nicholas. Thanks for being brave. Would you help Nicholas up? Hey, what's your name?
Vanessa.
Vanessa? High five, Vanessa. All right, thanks for coming. Step over here real fast. Hold my hand. And very gently, step right up there. Go ahead and step on.
No dancing.
Ready? Up you go.
A little more towards the middle.
Move towards the middle. Now do the cha-cha. I'm kidding. Don't dance. You're good. All right, give it up for Professor Croft. You comfy down there? Oh, yeah. All right, ready? Down you go. Ready, Nicholas? Down you go. All right. Oh, thank you so much, Mark. You feel better now?
Yeah, I feel better.
No. We're not done yet. Not quite yet. I have to explain to everybody how exactly that works while you're taking a rest. So, you may be asking, why isn't Professor Croft a Swiss cheese, Professor Croft? Why isn't he leaky? Well, here I have a couple small beds of nails to show you. That one is a bed of nails with very few nails. This is a bed of nails with slightly more nails. And this is a bed of nails with the most nails. And here I have balloons. Do nails pop balloons?
Yeah.
Of course they do! Or maybe not. So why didn't the balloon pop? Why isn't Professor Croft full of holes? What do you think? Go ahead. Yes, you little miss should be a scientist. I couldn't have said that better myself. That was amazing. There's so many nails. There's 3,000 nails on that bed of nails. And for the sake of ease, I'm going to say Professor Croft is 200 pounds. In reality, he's not. He's much lighter than that, not like me. So Professor Croft has 200 pounds of weight, which is a force. Professor Croft has 200 pounds of force as his weight. Those 200 pounds pressing down are shared amongst all 3,000 nails. So, the amount of pounds, the amount of force that is exerted on one nail is very, very little. It's much less than 1 pound per nail. Here I have a bed of nails and many nails. So if I push down with a force on the balloon, that force is spread over all the nails. Here I have a bed of nails with slightly fewer nails. If I push down, there's slightly more force per nail, but still not enough to pop the balloon. Here, I have the least amount of nails. Will that bed of nails pop the balloon? Of course, or why would I even ask? There you go, what kind of a show is it without pop balloons? There you go, you get two. But because everybody's new, I have a bed of nails for beginners. Any volunteers? Uh-oh, we got some in every crowd. Now, it takes 12 pounds of force to puncture human skin with one nail, which was my least favorite day in the lab. But that bed of nails right there would be 200 pounds of force for Professor Croft with just one nail. As it is now, he has much less than 1 pound per nail. I think he's reached his zen. Look at him. He's very relaxed. He's doing well. You know what, Professor? I got something else for you. Yep, something very relaxing. So you had some students and a blanket on you. Let's just give you a little something else. This is just a, no. It's just, you know, just to even things out a little bit. Don't stress. And here we have, thank you, Jess. And whoa, not yet. And here we have this. I promise it's not a guillotine. Think of it like one of those tanning shields. It's like a tanning shield. So Professor Croft, when he was my professor, gave me the, well, actually, he did not give me the A I needed.
What are you talking about that?
That time has passed. That time has passed. So let's do one last experiment. This will be our final experiment. It's our final show, our final experiment. So if he doesn't make it, it's really not a big deal. The experiment is, will Croft survive if I break this brick on his chest while he's on the bed of nails? Will he? Will he survive? Oh, at least half of them said no, Mark. I don't know. I need a countdown from three. Ready? 3, 2, 1. And he survives. Give it up for Professor Croft. Give it up for the crew in the back. Now, for those of you who are here, we have one last treat for you. For those of you who